The following program is rated TV-MAL. It contains strong language and is intended only for mature audiences.
Richard Waters, first known as MC Ricky D, then cemented his name as Slick Rick the Wolf. Rick was first introduced to hip-hop fans by the way of his longtime friend and musical partner, Dougie Fresh.
He was an established artist. He put me on, so he helped develop my step where I'm at now. And, you know, we're just thankful for all of that, you know what I mean? You know, each one pulls one up, like passing the baton type of stuff and all that.
Barry B, Chill Will. And also, Slick Rick.
Slick Rick,
right. Whether anybody believe it or not, we are, you know, me and Slick Rick will always be brothers to the end.
Before Def Jam, I was with Dougie Fresh and the Get Fresh crew. So we were doing our little one-hit wonders here, you know, boom, 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 like that. And some of that was easy.
As Slick Rick was contemplating being in the music business in the early 80s, he formed a bond with a few friends from his high school calling themselves the Kango Crew. As original member, Dana Dane explains in a 2009 interview.
Now, you know, Kango Crew, we were developed in music in our high school in the 80s, the early 80s, 79, 80s, and we went to school together in 125th Street, one part of the Fame School at the time, you know, and Slick Rick, Lance Brown, Kulaski, and Omega the Heartbreaker, and we just formed a little quick group, and we used to just do our thing in the lunchrooms, you know, creating little routines back in the day.
Making cute routines and stuff, you know, and then we used to wear the hat Kango, because Kango was part of the fashion of the game, you know. Anything to make yourself, anything to sell yourself, you know, sexy, whatever, you know. So we had the Kangos and the suit jackets, and we used to just play around like that, you know. Then when we got famous, we took it to the TVs.
The Bronx is known as the birthplace of hip-hop. Coming out of that section was no other than the ruler Slick Rick. As he breaks it down in the classic interview backstage with Fat Joe, KRS-One, and Rick Ross about his influences and the origins of hip-hop coming out of the Bronx.
I'd like to ask you this then. Since Joe was inspired by you and Chris, guess who was your inspiration then?
Cold Crush Brothers.
Cold Crush,
you know. They had it going on, something horrible back in the day in the Bronx, you know. That's where it all started from, you know. That's for all the cameras and the lights and all that, kid. You know what I mean? So, just gotta remember where you come from sometimes, you know what I mean? Keep it real, you know? We took an English language, we slanged it up, you know what I mean? And we just took it, we ran with it, and we created hip-hop, became a billion-dollar industry, you know what I mean? Don't forget where it came from. And as long as you got morals, as long as you got morals, kid, Cat will always be interested in your behind.
Rick would go on to be featured on two of Dougie Fresh's hip-hop classics, Lottie Dottie and The Show. That would give him the notoriety and confidence he needed to lay the foundation for things to come.
Well, in 1983-84, that was big noise at that time. You know, right now it may not be smut, but you know, because that's like 40 joints. But yeah, back then it was a problem. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was Dougie Fresh and me, and we was doing the beatbox, no music. It's like I'm talking to you right now.
Right.
You would just go, and I just say, Lottie Dottie, we like to party. We don't cause trouble. We don't bother nobody. Like that. And the next day, we just put it on in the studio, and it's so like it was a record.
Wow.
So, like how we talking right now,
right.
And we would take this conversation and put it on violin. And it sold.
Yeah.
This is how I'm saying. So we started from that with absolutely nothing. No instruments, no nothing. Just two people doing our thing, and it went to the stratosphere. So it just showed you that if two people can just use their voices and their beatboxing, we can make a living. You see what I'm saying? That's what we did back in 85 like that. It was ruckus. We went gold and platinum, all that, and it's the most sampled record to this day.
Slick Rick would eventually break off from Dougie Fresh and find his own lane in a new emerging genre of music called hip-hop. That would take place between the years of 1985 and 1987.
This is when Rick would perfect his craft and would sign a recording contract with the powerhouse label Def Jam.
we haven't seen anything like it. I mean, the closest thing was, I guess, Dana Dane, but it was Slick Rick.
Dane was Slick Rick.
But it was the Kango crew. They all kind of balled. I think Rick was first.
100%.
Right.
1,000%. Right. Well, I'm in a club in London.
And Rick was
all crazy.
And Rick was, like, in love with him, so he instantly signed a Def Jam contract. And Rick went to make his records.
Rick Rubin saw Slick Rick in a club in the UK and immediately signed him to a Def Jam recording contract, forcing the London-based rapper to come up with enough material to release an album.
Once they said 12, 13 records, you gotta get your stash. You gotta get all the shit you know that works. And if Run DMC wanna put in a movie, Tough of the Leather, you already know it's stash ready.
He was unlike anyone else. He had a tremendous personality. He was also really funny, great storyteller.
Of course, Slick Rick, as far as the creativity, you know, he wouldn't be the greatest storyteller.
I know everything from David Crockett, King of the Wild.
Slick Rick was completely unique, and in the same way that Public Enemy was unique, it was his own thing.
You had so many different flavors, so many different things going on. You had lyricism with Big Daddy Kane. You had lyricism with Rakim. You had lyricism with Kool G Rap. You had lyricism with LL Cool J. Like, there were so many different flavors to absorb sonically, man. I don't think there'll ever be a time like that.
You know, that's Slick Rick, the ruler. Oh, his music is timeless.
Thank you very much.
You know, he got. You know, Slick Rick got legitimate beef. That he might be the best ever, too.
Like Slick Rick, you know what I mean? That's like my idol right there. Like, you know what I mean? I get a lot of my storytelling from Slick Rick. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Even when I came with my eagle on and a lot of jewels and all that jewels, I got it from this man right here, B.
Slick Rick and DJ Vance Wright produced the album, creating such classics as Children's Story, Hey Young World, Mona Lisa, and Treat Her Like a Prostitute. Rick enlisted the help of Jam Master Jay, The Bomb Squad, Eric Sadler, and Rick Rubin to complete the classic album.
I made Children's Story, I made Mona Lisa, Hey Young World, and you know, the rest of them I made too, you know, but I wasn't too crazy about the music.
Slick Rick was not convinced that the album production was on the level that he needed it to be on and wasn't feeling the tracks that were provided. But according to Russell Simmons and Rick Rubin, Slick Rick went missing because of creative differences until he collaborated with Bomb Squad member Hank Shock Lee to finish the classic, The Great Adventures of Slick Rick.
And then it was just a lot of periods of you and Jay both trying to get him to meet you on time, try to make your record.
He just kind of he would disappear.
Right. And then Hank gelled with him, and they made the album like that. We depleted the budget, pretty much, fucking with him. And then Hank Shockley took the little rest of the budget and made the whole album.
I had to make sure that I had tracks that would sell myself, because relying on producers... Well, this is my smart, you know, theory, because sometimes you don't get lucky, you know what I mean? Relying on producers to make you famous don't always work, you know what I'm trying to say? So I had to put my own stuff together and make sure it sounded like a record and from scratch, and then you got to deal with a lot of politics.
Rick was signed to Def Jam in 1986, but it took 2 years for The Great Adventures of Slick Rick to actually hit the shelves.
New York mindset, you know what I mean? Was you make your joint, whether it's a cassette, whatever, then you gotta get connected into the radio. We needed to get this cassette to this cat and say, listen, when you get a chance, play this cassette. That's how the Rulers Back got out. This is while I was in this space between 86 and 88 with Def Jam. It was taking too long, you know what I mean? I need to keep my name alive. So I gave it to Red Alert. I said, Red, play this song. And he played it, and it took off. And it was just a cassette.
Despite his differences with the label, Rick's album shot to number one on Billboard's R&B and hip-hop charts, moving Rick to the forefront of the rap game, making him one of the premier storytellers of all time.
I already knew that some of them jokes was going to be a problem. Children's Story, I knew was going to be a problem. Mona Lisa, I knew it would be a problem. You already in the streets. They trying to sell to the streets. You already know the streets is in your pocket. So when I give it to them, they just going to spread it worldwide. So if you can run New York, if you can make noise in New York, you can make noise everywhere. Once you give it to the record label and they spread it, then you're good. So I already knew it was good. I was good.
Becoming the biggest artist on Def Jam and one of the biggest artist in hip-hop in 1988 was a huge accomplishment, but sometimes success and ego can get in the way. As the late Steezo explains the beef between Slick Rick and Big Daddy Kane.
The bow was set straight for the cop shooting. The cop got scared, the kidney starts to jigger. All the years if I pull this trigger.
And I seen them guys, they were arguing on the side of the stage. Like, who's gonna go on first or last, you know. Both of them were good. They both were let, you know, these guys are some of the hottest rappers ever in the game. So, you know, they're arguing over who's gonna go on first and last, who wants to be last.
So they're making this big commotion.
Yeah, they're making this big commotion.
You know, before Great Adventures dropped, but yeah, we were real close. And I guess after it dropped, he said something in the magazine that I didn't like.
What'd he say?
I believe they asked him, like, he was talking about rappers, you know, that he felt he was better than. They asked him about me, and he said, Kane is cool, but if he got in my way, I'd crush him too. Mm. You know?
And this is your man at the time.
Yeah.
So what happened, man?
What happened was we were starting a tour. Mm-hmm. And they asked me, you know, to be a part of it. And I was like, well, what's Rick getting? Mm-hmm. I was like, all right, well, I need this much more, and mm-hmm. I got to go on after him.
Mm-hmm. And I guess Slick took off his jewelry. He had all his jewelry connected to one piece, and he took it off, and he put it in his Kangol hat. And he was just like, yo, what? And then Kane was like, what? And so Slick pulls out. I don't know if y'all seen the pictures of him with the 2 380s, the gold 380s. He pulled the joints out. And then
on the Kane, side of the stage.
On the side of the stage. And then School pulled, he backed out something, and it was about to be a draw. I'm like, yo, what's getting ready to go on? They getting ready to shoot this and that.
You know, so instead of replying, I just chose to mess with his ego. Yeah,
this was payback.
Yeah. I just chose to just mess with his ego. Mm. And you know, it worked to where, you know, they wanted to, you know, renegotiate everything and work it out where we could flip flop order. Mm-hmm. Like one night I go after him, next night he go after me.
Right.
You know. And one of these nights, something went wrong where I came late, which wasn't my fault, it was LL's tour manager's fault, mm-hmm. timing wise. And you know, we ended up having an altercation, you know, on backstage.
It was about to be a draw. I'm like, yo, what's getting ready to go on? They getting ready to shoot this and that. And then it was just a quick little scuffle. Kane threw a couple of blows, and they backed up, broke it up. And but I mean, if you look at the whole story, I mean, Kane got him with about 2 or 3 punches before they broke it up. So. So, but it would have got ugly, but I couldn't believe that they pulled out the guns. I almost didn't even think the guns were real.
In between the years of 1988 and 1990, Rick would find himself in real big trouble, facing jail time for an attempted murder charge.
In March of 1991, rapper Slick Rick was convicted of attempted murder in the second degree and weapons possession. He was later sentenced to serve 3 1/3 to 10 years in a New York State penitentiary for shooting at his cousin and one-time bodyguard Mark Plummer and injuring an innocent bystander. Rick, who in a separate incident was shot at a Bronx social club weeks earlier, alleges that Plummer had threatened his life and that he fired at him out of fear.
The big question that I'm sure the parole board will ask you, and that I know that society wants to hear, is, do you feel remorse for what you did?
Yeah, I guess I would say I handled it in an adolescent type of a fashion. You know what I'm saying? I should have handled it in a more, you know, adult fashion. You know what I'm saying? Because right now I'm suffering. My son is suffering. You know what I'm saying? I could be out there. I could have. 5 years of my life went to waste, you know what I'm saying?
That would put the fledgling superstar behind bars. Prior to his sentencing of 5 years, he would be bailed out by Russell Simmons to work on his second album, The Ruler's Back.
Hey, we got Vance Wright over here. What's up, Vance Wright?
How you doing, brother?
All right, cool. Talking to the mic. We got it. So, Vance, tell us a little bit about what you did on the album.
Me and Rick did the whole album, mm-hmm. and slamming.
You slamming?
Slamming.
What are some of the tracks like? I mean, musically, did you do anything different? Because the tracks y'all do are always pumping.
Yeah, well, we tried to, you know, be unique with a lot of the samples and not, you know, try and use a lot of stuff that's been used already. So got a lot of different stuff, new sounds that haven't been heard before.
Tell you a story and I come out bluntly. Want an ugly child, ain't nobody would want me. I used to walk around and get upset and upsetter, till I figured out ways to make myself look better. As I got older, my awareness expanded. I met this beautiful girl and my wish was commanded.
As Rick explains the process and pressure of him recording his album in between jail time, also chiming in is producer DJ Prince Paul.
Recording Slick Rick. This is when he was kind of out of jail to record. I remember, I think Russell Simmons paid his bail to be out to make this one album. It was behind bars.
Because I was bailed out for 3 weeks and I had to do 2 albums in 3 weeks, you know, so it was a lot of pressure. So it was no real chemistry. Like, they would take the raps and put it with a track that was, they was never there at the same time. You know, a lot of things was never there at the same time. And like I said, I could make a bunch of excuses all day, but it was two whack albums. I apologize to the public for that, you know what I'm saying?
You know, you can tell he's tired, he's been recording the whole time. Yo, but the coolest thing is just as I sit here on a stool, it's like, yeah, let me get coffee, get a cigarette, get this book. And just starts rattling off rhymes like it's nothing, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, like effortlessly.
But this joint here is like the first joint, it's the real second album, and like I said, party's on again, and that avenue is wide open for Rick for some reason.
Slick Rick was given 3 weeks to complete 2 albums before doing his jail time of 5 years, which was The Ruler's Back and Behind Bars in 1994. After coming home, the Bronx Raised rap star was at it again with what he would consider his real second album, The Art of Storytelling. With the lead single called Street Talkin', featuring the Dirty South superstar, Big Boy from the multi-platinum group, Outkast. Bulldoggin' and bowhoggin', now bowhoggin' and pimp-walkin', and strictly dressin' street talkin', over y'all ass like that, dad. Going them all up like cat hair, we never fall off like hat wear, with some of the dopest MPs out there, now eat that. Outkast and Ricky D, can you beat that? Remember the time I laid them down, a teenage love, I see that just...
I do it because I love the craft, you know what I mean? It's like God gave me a gift. He said, yo, have your fun this round, you know what I mean? I used to be a mail clerk, you know what I'm saying, Joe? Right up, Kels is a mail clerk, little library clerk, police law firms, you know what I'm saying?
I was a mail dude. I ran the mail room at a TV station, Rick. I feel you. So I feel you. You going where you gotta go.
Yeah, so I was a little mail clerk, you know what I mean? And it just blew up. So, boom, man, everybody likes to see a star, you know what I'm saying? Ain't no wrong with looking good, you know what I mean?
No.
So boom, yo, they on some platinum tip now, so boom, might as well get the platinum tip. You know what I'm saying?
But what made you wear all the jewelry, man? What originally made you say, I'm a...
Because I grew up in this environment, this Bronx environment, and I saw beauty. You see beauty once, you either embrace it or you reject it. I don't care who had it on. Could have been a pimp, a drug dealer, a nice guy, a celebrity. Once you see beauty, you embrace it. Nice car. Uh-huh. Don't everybody embrace BMs and Benzes and Rolls Royces? It's not, there's nobody good difference who's driving it. It's beauty.
Mm-hmm.
You embrace it.
Slick Rick was like the Mr. T of the rap game. As Mr. T being one of Rick's influence, Rick was able to take his jewelry game to another level. Even though Slick Rick was fired up and ready to go, Def Jam would only release that one single and video of Rick's final album in 1999, The Art of Storytelling, would be Rick's highest charting album, coming in at number 8 on the Billboard charts. Although not his most successful album, the album did go certified gold in about 30 days. His savvy style of dressing with high fashion garments made Rick stand out as well. Known for his pound and pounds of gold and diamond jewelry, Rick was definitely in a class of his own.
I looked at it like a variety thing at first, you know what I mean? Like, you got your lane, I got my lane, variety, you know? I'm more humor and shit like that. You are more like battle, complex. When they came in the game, the game started getting changed, so it's almost like the whole game became like a one battle, not variety anymore. So now you gotta step up your intricacy. Everybody had like lines like, you suckers. Mine was, you crumbs, you peasants. When it came like that, you almost had to force yourself to stay in the mix like that, like stay in a battle rap type of a situation. But my strength still was more like stories and humor.
Slick Rick could still be seen on stage doing what he's known for doing best, which is rocking the crowd with his nostalgic gold jewelry and classic hits. His contribution and influence to his culture is unique in every way, and for this, we want to give Slick Rick his flowers. I'm Paris PMD Smith, and on behalf of Kraze the King of Content, until next time, peace.
Still living. It's 100% proof of champions of truth, and if you feel you need spirit, I'll bring back your youth. The ruler's back. Trying to sound like